they may become the third category. They may turn eventually into the third category, which we call confidants. Comrades, who are the brothers in arms, can become brothers for life. There is a chance of that. But that does not necessarily have to happen all the time. That you will have people who will fight along with you for a common vision, who will go with you to a common goal, but they don't necessarily have to go with you all your life. So you can't really depend on them. You can't share your life with them. It would be foolish for you to share your life with them. But here is the third category, and you would want to have a person like that in your life, and you would want to become a person like that to others. A confidant is somebody with whom you can trust with your life. You can confide anything with them. You can absolutely be sure of this, that they will be there for you anytime you need them. All the time you need them. Their motivation is simple: unconditional love for you. They're not gaining anything out of you. They simply love you. And they have no conditions for doing what they are doing for you. They are with you. Ideally, this is where we all want to be. Not only just to have friends like that, but we want to be like that. People unconditionally friends with others. And we don't have any expectations. We just want to help them, help others to become better. It's necessary. That's why it's necessary for us to distinguish these categories of people who call so-called friends in our lives and have a careful the kind of people you want to have in your life. Whoever walks with the wise becomes wise. Psalmist says, the wise man says in Proverbs chapter 13, verse 20, whoever walks with the wise becomes wise, but the companion of fools will suffer. So it's not just important to have friends in our lives, it's really important for us to have friends who are wise in our lives. And confidants are wise people. It's my challenge to you today that you become a person like that. I could have taught you from the angle of what kind of friends you can have, but I want to teach you today on what kind of friend you can become to others. Would that make sense? So that we have a fair understanding of what we want to become and what kind of people we want to have in our lives. You see, it's really important for us to understand this verse, Proverbs chapter 18, verses 24. Every verse that I'm talking about friendship, if you have friends, you need to underline them. Really, they become the standard measurement for you. Chapter 18, verses 24. There are friends who destroy each other, but a real friend sticks closer than a brother. A real friend sticks closer than a brother. So basically, Wiseman is saying a confidant is actually a brother. In fact, he becomes a brother to you. It does not necessarily mean that that person would agree with everything that you do, but this is a person on whom you can depend on. You can just leave your life in their hands and believe that they're going to take care of that. Those are the kind of people you want to become, you want to have in your life. I read this brilliant article on qualities of a true friend. I've had a different outline for this series, for this message. But I changed it because the article impressed my heart so much that I felt this is exactly how I want to teach, what I want to teach to people. So I'm not a 7-point guy, I'm usually a 3-point guy, but for today, let me become a 7-point guy. 7 qualities of a true confidant, true brother, true friend, whatever you want to call it. 7 qualities that the wise man describes throughout the book of Proverbs. Number one, good friends are dependable. Good friends are dependable, but bad ones are fair weather friends. Like the guy, the way wearing tennis shoes. Bad friends are fair weather friends. Chapter 17, verses 17 of Proverbs. A friend loves at all times. Not necessarily in good times, but all times. A brother is born for adversity. I love the way he expressed that. A brother is born in adversity. In other words, the wise man is saying, when you face adverse conditions in your life, that's when true brothers come into your life. I don't know if you remember, we did a series on Satan. We need to do that series one more time here. Starting with how Satan works in our lives, we talked about that and how we can defend ourselves from the strategies of Satan. But the first message I did on that series is called The Value of an Enemy. Why do we need an enemy in our lives? Why is it so important for us to have enemies in our lives? And one of the reasons I gave is this, that it is an enemy who helps you to understand who is your true friend. It is your worst enemy that helps you to find your best friend in life. Without an enemy, everybody is a friend. Without an adverse condition, everybody is a friend. But when you face a loss of a job, when you face a loss of, face a financial debacle and bankruptcy, when you lose a job, when your marriage crumbles, when a relationship breaks, your heart is broken and you're down, deep down in the valley, the guy who stays with you is your true friend. When he has every reason to walk away from you, when he has every reason to abandon you from in the place that you are in, but he chooses to stand alongside you, that's the guy who you want in your life. He's our Jonathan. David found Jonathan, and it was such a great gift from God to David. First Samuel chapter 20, verses 17, talks about how David and Jonathan entered into this pact between themselves, that made a covenant with each other, saying that, hey, we're going to be best friends for life. If I'm alive, I'm going to take care of you. If you're alive, you're going to take care of me. If I'm dead, you're going to take care of my family. If you are dead, I'm going to take care of your family, kind of covenant. They both entered. And that verse beautifully describes what took place between both of them. It says, Jonathan loved David as he loved his own soul. Jonathan loved David as, that's the same love wise man is talking in Proverbs chapter 17. A friend loves at all times. This is a love that is unconditional. It is dependable. You can believe them. That's the kind of friends we want in our lives. That's the kind of friend we want to be. He's loyal. Solomon says, brotherhood is born during the time of adversity, and that faithfulness, that friend shows towards you is something that you want to emulate, you want to follow, you want to have in your life. Another proverb, Proverbs chapter 19, verses 22, gives a different dimension to that. It says this, what is desired in a man is steadfast love. What is desired of a man is steadfast love. There are very few occasions where God says, this is what I want from you. What God looks for a man is a man who loves, walks in, who loves justice, who loves mercy, walks humbly, and do justice. You remember that? That's a verse. This is what the expectation of God from us, and this is another expectation. What is desired from a man? A steadfast love. Basically, the word steadfast in Hebrew is a word called hesed. Hesed means undivided loyalty, radical loyalty. This is a faithfulness that's not compartmentalizing friends. Okay, I'm going to be with this guy for some time. I'm going to be with that guy for some time. I'm going to be with this person for some season. I'll remain loyal to them, but only for this particular job or this particular thing. This is an undivided loyalty towards you. Whether you're good or bad, whether you treat me well or not, I'm still going to be your friend. Once I made an pact with you, I'm staying with you, man. I'm not going anywhere from here. Kind of loyalty. There's only one person who showed that kind of loyalty, God. Paul talks about that in Romans and says this, even though we are unfaithful, he remains faithful. It's a very interesting thought to think through. Basically, what Paul is saying is this, that even if you messed up your friendship with God, God is not going to do that. He's going to remain faithful to you, loyal to you. That's amazing. That we have a God like that who shows so much love towards us and faithfulness towards us. So we want to have a person like that in our lives. We want to become a person like that, a friend who is dependable in any circumstances. When lives fall apart, when marriage ends, when you lose a job, when there is a death in the family, when you're physically harmed, you want to have a friend who stays by your side during that time. And when you have a friend like that, if you have a friend like that, don't leave them. Hold on to them. Hold on to your Jonathans. Some of us would have gone through similar experiences like that, and we would have, said to our surprise, found our Jonathans. And they stayed with us. Chances are some of you had the opposite experience. that it could be possible that some of you had gone through such bitter experience in your life, and then you just found yourself so lonely that almost all the people that you thought your best friends were just hands off, walking away from you. And it could be possible that because of that bitter experience, that you don't want to trust people. You don't want to develop friendships. But I want to tell you this, that there are people who can be dependable. We'll talk about a little more on them, but there are still people who you can trust and depend on. God put people like that around you, Jonathans. Good friends are dependable, bad ones are fair weather. Number two, good friends are honest about their sin. Bad ones are deceptive about it. Good friends are honest about their sin, but bad friends are deceptive about it. One of the ways friendship works is accountability. The word accountability is overused in Christendom, you know. And of course now, on, you know, even in the leadership and management circles, we're using the word accountability as if, you know, it's just another word. But accountability actually means this, that being honest about ourselves with our trusted friends about our temptations, about our sins, and about the state of our heart. If you can sit with a friend and tell him, hey, you know, this is the kind of temptation I'm facing, this is the kind of sin that I've committed, and this is where my heart is, I really don't want to believe in God. I'm really going through this bad patch in my life. I don't know whether God really cares for me or not. You understand, you know what I'm talking about? When you can talk like that to a friend, that's a friend you want in your life. When somebody can talk to you like that, that means that you're becoming a friend like that. A true friend is honest about their life, honest about their sin. But chances are most of us are deceptive about it. Even when it comes to accountability, we are very deceptive about it. Like this, like some of us would just simply want to avoid any confrontation with any of our friends with the realities of our life. We would make sure that if the point comes up in our discussions about a personal sin, about a personal area of our life, we would make sure that we would come up with another story that simply masks what the original problem is. We are masters of avoiding confrontations, avoiding accountability. Some of us, not all of you, but some of us. Or we'll just simply shut our mouth up and don't want to answer the questions. We plead the Fifth Amendment, you know. I know it's not Fifth Amendment for us, but in America, the Fifth Amendment is, I don't want to say anything that will criminally incriminate me. So you know you did wrong, you don't want to say that. You know that if you open your mouth, you're going to confess it, so you don't want to do that. Zip it, just sit quiet. How can friendships work when something like that happens? Or we are deceptive by playing the we game. You know what the we game is? This. That we might have a conversation with our Christian brother or brothers about a struggle that, you know, that that we are facing, and they ask us, how can we help you? And then the chances are some of us are masters of this game. The game is simple. You know how it is, right? You really know. When you face a temptation, we'll all fall, you know, just like how we... The I goes, we comes. You're basically bringing the guy who's trying to help you into the game. To the worst thing is this, the guy who actually asked you would end up feeling that I did something wrong. Maybe we should start changing our defense strategy. You know? And actually the best way to defend, best way to help ourselves is to be open about what's happening in our lives. I have a problem. I know I shouldn't have done that. I want to become better. If you can use the word the I when it comes to your personal sin, you're becoming honest. Or maybe some of us confess, but on a surface level. This is probably most people, the game that most people play, is this, that we will confess our sin, but on a sanitized version. Like we never get to details, we never talk about the intentions, we never talk about what really took place. We'll just simply, on the surface, confess it, and hopefully that people, you know, hope that people will forget it, or the guy who we talk to would take sympathize with you. We heavily edit it, like our censor board in India, and you know, sanitize everything that we share with people, so that people will not look down on us, so that we don't lose our face values. So you know, that's our problem. Or maybe we play the game called musical chairs. I tell you, we have some good experts in musical chairs. And they play this. This that you have more than one person you share your heart, your sin, or your mess, but you will not share everything with them. So one person gets to know one side of the story, little bit of that story. Another person gets a little bit of another story of the same story, little side, another side, another one. Problem is, nobody knows what actually happened, and you are safe in the process. Everybody thinks you are good, because you just presented the version that they would like to hear of the story, but nobody knows exactly what took place. There are some experts in church, not necessarily our church, but in church in general, who do that. They're deceiving. Whom are they deceiving? They're deceiving themselves. You don't want to be a friend like that, neither do you want to have a friend like that. That the games are games of deception. Bending the truth, it's much easier for us to crucify our image, but go deeper in our friendships, which will help us to have foster good relationships, good friends. That's number two. Number three, good friends are trustworthy. Bad ones are gossips. Now that's a no-brainer. Everybody knows that. So the first one says good friends are dependable. When I say dependable, I'm saying they are there with you in any circumstance that you need them to be there. They are there with you. When I talk about good friends are being trustworthy, I'm talking about people who keep everything that you share in their hearts. Nothing comes out of their mouth. What you share with them stays with them. What you share with them, not even a single word comes out of their mouth. They're never going to talk about that to others. Those are true friends. They're trustworthy. Proverbs chapter 16, verses 28. A dishonest man spreads strife, and a whisperer separates close friends. I know the word whisperer sounds so polished. Basically, he's saying a gossiper. That's all he's saying. A gossiper separates close friends. After all that I talked about confessing our sins to others and, you know, accountability, I also want to just make sure that you understand you need to know whom you confess your sins to, whom you are accountable to. That's why you know, the second point and third point are also connected. I'm asking you to confess, be accountable, but at the same time be accountable to a person who is trustworthy. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verses 13, Paul calls these kind of people as busybodies. Basically, their only job is this. They want to get closer to you so that they know everything that's happening in your life, so that they can then take it and broadcast it everywhere. If you talk to a person like that, it would have been much better for you to print it on a newspaper. You know, it spreads faster than anything. They just like to talk about others to everybody else, and that's their business. Here is something, you know this, but something that I want to repeat for you to remember one more time as a reminder is this, that if somebody walks up to you and gossips about another person to you, I can give you 100% guarantee that they're going to talk about you to somebody else. If somebody is constantly talking to you about another person, please know that. Don't even open your mouth to them. Listen to them. Be quiet. Soak in all the information. Don't talk. Because they're definitely going to talk about you to others. The same guy, probably about whom they bought the information to you, they will take the same information to them about you. Does it make sense? And you know this. You're smart. But how do we know the people like this? How do we know their intentions? We really can't. Because we're humans. So the only way to know those kind of people is to ask the Holy Spirit to help us. And the Holy Spirit is willing to do that. He calls it the gift of discernment. One of the gifts of the Holy Spirit in the Bible is a gift called discernment. We are all born with already a gift. It's called conscience. Conscience is given to every human being, whether they are Christians or not Christians, whether they are followers of Jesus or not followers of Jesus. Everyone has a conscience. Whether they know God, believe in God, deny God, it doesn't matter. Everybody has a conscience. The conscience is a gift from God to mankind. The gift simply tells you what is good and what is bad. That's why even a child knows when he does something wrong, even before anybody tells him that you have done wrong. They know they have done wrong. But the gift of discernment is the ability to distinguish between what is godly and what is evil. What is coming from God and what is evil. The gift of discernment, if used properly, would enable us to gauge a person. Would enable us to understand what that person's intentions are when they're talking to you. It's a gift. And it's not hidden. It's a gift that is open. If you want it, he will give it to you. Bible says that. I'm not saying that. It's a gift of the Holy Spirit. You can have it if you just ask for it. So ask for it. God, I trusted somebody before, unwisely trusted somebody before. They broke my heart. They just spilled my life open to everybody. And now I'm in a position not to trust anybody. So therefore, I can't trust anybody. But I want to trust because that's what, you know, what makes you a good friend. If I have to trust, I need discernment. Ask God, he will give you discernment to pick the right people. Number four, good friends lovingly confront. Bad ones are spiritual wimps. Good friends lovingly confront. Bad ones are spiritual wimps. Proverbs chapter 27, verse 6. Faithful are the wounds of a friend, but profuse are the kisses of an enemy. Look at what is, this is almost like a, you know, clear explanation of how friends look like. How we expect things to be is this. He's saying, we usually prefer the kisses of an enemy because they smell well, they profuse. But it's much better to be hurt by a friend because he's faithful. What we need to be and what we need to have in our lives is good friends who lovingly confront us about our sin, about our life, about things that we are doing wrong. It's good to have people like that. If you have a friend who can walk up to you and talk to you freely and call you for accountability, spiritual accountability, please keep him around. Please keep her around. They'll help you to become better. If you need to be one, please become one. But the spiritual wimps are like this. They confess each other, their sins to each other, and then they're going to say, tu kara, mai kara, let's just pat our backs and let's go. I'm sure God will forgive both of us, don't worry about this. Could there be a possibility that some of us Christians, looking for Christians like that, who would ignore your sin because you're ignoring their sin? That our friendships are primarily based on that, you know, absolution of our sin just by, you know, we're like looking for confession booths, you know. Sometimes our prayers are like that. Have you ever thought about the bedside prayers that you offer? God, thank you for this day. What a wonderful day it's been. Thank you for taking care of me. Thank you. Please forgive me my sins if I did something wrong. The next day, exactly repeat the same sins and go back to the bed and pray the exact same prayer. We think God is a confession booth. But a good brother wisely knows we don't need cheap grace. We don't need cheap peace. What we need is hard truth spoken to us so that it can change our lives. Like Nathan, who walked up to David. Nathan is a great friend of David. David is a king. But what David did is wrong. Nathan knows what David did is wrong because God told him that David did wrong with Bathsheba and Uriah. And Nathan walked up to David. First of all, it takes guts for you to stand up in front of the king and tell the king, hey, you are the thief. But it takes a friend to stand up to David and say, David, I love you, but what you've done is wrong. But I'm here to help you. I'm not here to condemn you, but I'm here to help you. That's the kind of friend we want to have in our lives, isn't it? A friend who doesn't go back and talk about us, but actually comes up to us, talks to us, helps us to overcome our struggle. When a friend wounds your pride, it's not intended to harm you, but in fact to heal you. If you need a new heart, you don't go to a pharmacist who gives you a pain medication. You go to a doctor who cuts open your chest and works on your heart. Remember this, Proverbs chapter 27, verses 17. Iron sharpens iron, and one man sharpens another. We like it, you know, the iron sharpens iron. But what happens when an iron sharpens another iron? Friction takes place. So obviously, when you honestly go and confront another person, or when somebody who loves you comes and confronts you, there is going to be friction. Of course there is going to be friction. Sparks going to fly. Of course your emotions are going to get stirred up, you're going to get angry. All that things are going to happen, but ultimately they're going to help you to become sharper. Does it make sense to you? Find a friend like that. You may not like what they're talking to you, but at least they'll help you to become better. C.S. Lewis wisely says this, that, you know, you will not find a warrior or a philosopher or a poet or a Christian, at least friend, by staring into their eyes as if they were their mistress. But he says this, when you fight beside them, pray with them, read with them, argue with them, you will know whether that person is a warrior or a friend or a poet or a philosopher. We need brothers who will stand alongside us, fight sin that is in our lives together. Good friends, that being said, the next one is very important. Good friends know when to cut you slack. I did say good friends need to confront with truth, but it is also important for us to balance with this fifth quality. Good friends know when to cut you slack. Bad ones have a cop mentality. You see, the problem is this. Some of us, in the name of confronting our friends with truth, become cops. That's our problem. That means everything that they do is wrong. We will try and find faults with everything that they said, everything that they do. That's cop mentality. That's not a good friend you want to have in your life. But good friends know when to show grace. Good friends know this, that we are human beings and we fail. They know that we will mess up things. They know that we will make mistakes. They're not going to come back and nitpick on you every time you did something wrong. They're not going to keep coming back to you and repeat you again and again the sins that you have committed. Look at Proverbs chapter 17, verses 9. Whoever covers an offense seeks love. They're not hiding the sin that you've done, but they're covering you, protecting you. Good friend covers with love. But he who repeats a matter separates close friends. Did you see in the span of last 20 minutes, we looked at two different verses that talk about separating good friends, close friends. The first one who separates close friends is the guy who gossips. This is the second guy who separates close friends. The guy who keeps repeating the sin the other guy has committed. Again and again. So, you don't want to become a nitpicky friend like that. But in a book called Samson and the Pirate Monks, the author writes a parable, an interesting parable about how some Christians feel inside the church, in their plug-in groups, in their small groups, and what can happen. And I want to read that for you. It's an interesting experience of a Christian who go, and it could be possible that it is your experience too. You've probably seen this poor fellow who decided that one day to be honest in a Christian meeting. Maybe he'd been caught in a sin, or so he really has nothing left to lose. Or perhaps he was so plagued by the guilt that he decided to take the church rhetoric about grace and forgiveness at face value and bare his soul in a small group in his desperate need for freedom. As soon as those fateful words about the sin that he has committed were uttered, he looked around, hoping somebody would say, "Me too." But all he heard were crickets. After a pause, a curious investigator launched into a spiritual cross-examination. "What made you to do what you did? How did you do what you did? Could you have done it differently?" Then a few concerned ex-sinners gathered around him and preached a series of sermons disguised as prayers. "Father, help my brother to confess his sin. Make sure he never does this again with his wife." You know, the ex-sinners who pray sermons in the form, you would have had some of those, put their arms around you. Finally, a helpful brother prescribed three scripture verses to be taken in the morning and in the bedtime before the lunch and, you know, dinner and breakfast and those stuff. Later, another guy was assigned as a probation officer, as an accountability partner, who would take check on him for a few weeks to make sure that he actually turned around and became true Christian. To make matters worse, as he left the meeting, that poor guy was struck by the realization that he had just become, he had just volunteered to become the church news for the Sunday. And sure enough, the next Sunday, as he walked into the church, his suspicions were confirmed because of the sidelong glances, the awkward silences, the careful distances kept by the former associates, their wives and others, verified that his disclosure was now a common currency in the church. I don't know if it was your experience in this church. Hopefully not. But I do hope that doesn't happen here. That I do hope that we build a church that doesn't have a cop mentality. That we are not too legalistic about everything. That we do have grace, offer second chances, 10 chances, 100 chances, 1,000 chances, or maybe chances till you take the last breath. I do want to be like that because I'm offered like that every single day of my life. Sometimes love is better served by silence. Understand that. Christians, have come up with very religious and sanitized ways to be jerks. Sorry for using that word, and I thought that's the only way to put my point across. We don't need any more accountability cops. What we need is friends who understand people fail, and it's okay, and give another chance. Does that make sense? Okay, so a true friend is somebody who, of course, confronts with truth, but at the same time, who knows when to cut you slack. Number six. Good friends are realists, but bad friends are foolishly cheery. Some of us don't really know when to show optimism, We are like this eternal optimist. I know the word sounds nice, eternal optimism, but it really hurts people, by the way. It really puts other people off. I didn't say that. The wise man said that. Let's look at that. Proverbs chapter 25, verses 20. Whoever sings songs to a heavy heart is like the one who takes off a garment on a cold day. Think of that expression, huh? On a cold day, you want more clothes on you. But sometimes we have friends who will come to you and take your clothes off on a cold day. He says they're like that. Like they're like the vinegar on a soda. Complete opposite things, right? And soda becomes redundant when you pour vinegar in it. Says there are some of us might have had friends like that who would say, "Look on the bright side," the look on the bright side guy. You tell him you just lost a job, he's going to look at you and say, "Well, at least you have health." Really? I just lost a job, man. Look on the bright side guy. Or maybe a class clown guy, a guy who, no matter how there is no serious movement with him. No matter how serious your problem is, no matter what you, as you bear your heart out to that person seriously, and you do hope that this person would help you, he somehow finds a time to crack a joke in the name of good fun. I'm not really in a mood to smile, man. You want to tell that to him, but you really can't, right? Or there is this super spiritual guy who, you know, who would come up with all kinds of explanations, like, maybe there is a sin in your life. Maybe you need to confess that. You just lost a job. And he's talking to you and saying, maybe there is a sin. Or maybe he'll say, you know, we all praise God in all circumstances. Yes, I know. I know we need to praise God in all circumstances. Not right now. I'm not in a mood to do that. I just lost a job. I'd rather have a friend who'll just put his arms around me. Not say a single word. Good friends are realists. They're not foolishly cheery. You want to have a friend like that. You want to become a friend like that. Who understand life means struggles. Who understands that we face problems together. A realist is someone who knows that there is more to life than just feeling good. Does that make sense? That feeling good is necessary, but I think being good is much more important. Becoming good is much more important. So true friend is always helping us to become better rather than make us feel good. Number 7. Good friends focus on your heart. Bad ones see only the surface. Let me just take that in a minute and we'll close. Proverbs chapter 20, verses 5. The purpose in a man's heart is like a deep water, but a man of understanding will draw it out. I love it. I think that's the explanation of a true friend. Basically, this is what he's saying. Every action that we commit in our lives, everything that we do in our lives, has a purpose. There was some reason why you did what you did. There's some reason why you're feeling the way you're feeling. What you say may not be the true reason. What you did may not be the true expression of what is going on in your heart. There's always something going deep down in your heart. But a true friend is the guy who's going to draw that out. He's not going to judge you by the actions that you committed or judge you, get offended by the words that you uttered. He's going to take time to get deep into your life, deep into your heart, and draw that out. And that's how he's going to help you. I wish that we would become like that. That we talk less, judge less, and become people with understanding. A little bit of wisdom for you today. Choose your friends wisely, and you'll never need to be lonely. Choose your friends wisely, you'll never need to be lonely. Let me add a statement to that. Become one. A friend who can who's the man of understanding, woman of understanding to others. Become one friend so that others can don't feel lonely in their life. There's nobody else. The best example for us is Christ, of course. Paul talks about it and he says this, the Lord stood by me and strengthened me. Isn't that what we look for in friends? The one who stands by us. But not just stand by us, but strengthen us. That even at your weakest point, he'll make you feel like a giant. That as long as that person is beside you, man, you can conquer the world. Even though you know you can't. But you know just because of that person, I can do anything. We all want people like that in our lives. But it only begins when we become like that. Let's close our eyes. Take a moment to ask God to give you discernment to choose your friends wisely. That's going to be your prayer today. And then ask God to help you to become one of those friends who is dependable, who is trustworthy, who becomes a strength to others. A simple prayer. And I will pray with you. Father, we want to thank you for this morning service. We thank you, God, that your word is always encouraging us and God showing us in the right direction. Today we together pray. Understand that we understand that we all need true friends. And so give us discernment in choosing our friends wisely, God. But most importantly, help us to become one good, wise friend to others. A friend who exhibits dependability, trustworthiness, and a heart that becomes a strength to others. Help us to become a church that is like that. That we don't judge people with cop mentality, but we do help people with love. So help us, God, not just in this church, but help us to become like that in our families, in our workplaces, in the world that you placed us in. We thank you for Jesus, who is our friend. He is the best example that we can have and follow. Today, as we depart from here, we thank you for what a friend we have in Jesus. And as we look to him, follow him, help us to become a friend like Jesus to others. Bless you, God, for the opportunity to worship you together in this place. Thank you for those who joined us for the first time today at our service. I pray that you would bless them. If it is your will, bring them back to us to worship along with us and to share fellowship with us, so that we can grow together, edifying each other, building your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Would you like to stand to your feet? Let's do the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from all evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now may the love of our Father, and the grace of his Son, Jesus Christ, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit, be with each one of us, now and forever. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful week. This week, we have a leadership conference happening, conducted by us on 14th and 15th. We have a lot of pastors who are coming from across both the states. Some capstones are joining. So if you still want to be part of that, 14th and 15th is, take the time out. All the resource people are wonderful men of God. You can learn some very good Christian leadership principles from their lives. All right? Okay, God bless you. Have a wonderful week.